As we have our online lecture on the Gospel of Matthew. Today, as our church is celebrating the World Day for the Grandparents and the Elderly, we gratefully remember our roots, our own grandparents this day, that it is through them that you have imparted your faith in us. Jesus' parents, Suvakin and Anne, had a role to play, as the Holy Father says, in the way he understood the world, understood human persons. Bless this evening as we are here to listen to you, listen to the resource person on the Gospel of Matthew. Bless our chairman. Bless Father Naveen, the resource person of the day. Bless all our students and the participants of this class. That this learning may be fruitful, so that we, having learned the Gospel of Matthew, may be true followers, true disciples of your Son, now and always. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Good evening, Your Excellency, Most Reverend Dr. Anthony Swamiji Ravi, the Chairman of the CCBA Commission for Bible, Reverend Father Naveen Repello, dear participants, good evening to you all. May I request His Excellency to introduce us the speaker of the day and also give his words of blessing.
Yeah, dear Reverend Father Naveen and Repello, and Father S. Ganadi, the secretary of our commission, and all the participants of this online Bible course college. Good evening, everyone. Today, now we are going to deal with the Gospel of Matthew, the Gospel of the Church, or as Father Weingart says, is the Gospel of the Catechism. And you know, this gospel traditionally is called the first gospel because of the tradition or the writings of Papias or Irenaeus, Origen, and also Jerome. Saint Jerome says Matthew, who is also called Levi, a former tax collector, then an apostle, first composed a gospel of Christ in Judea. So that in Greek, in the Judean language, that means Greek or Aramaic. So according to this tradition, we always, for many centuries, it is thought that this is the first gospel of the New Testament of the Gospel series, four Gospels. But then after scientific research from last century onwards, we come to understand that the Greek Gospel, which we have today, translated in many languages, is not the first Gospel, but Mark is the first Gospel. But then there is a strong, not just opinion, but then is a research scholarly opinion that Aramaic gospel of the, there was something written, sayings of Jesus by Matthew in Aramaic, but which does not, we don't have it, but after 70s, basing on the sayings of Jesus and also Gospel of Mark. Now, a disciple of Matthew, or even Matthew when he was living, they composed the present Greek text of the Gospel, which is called the Gospel of the Church, we can say in a way. So we know this gospel according to, I don't want to deal with the whole text or the composition, because Our speaker of today is really well, very much well versed in this gospel, and he will be giving us a very clear picture, not the whole gospel's theology or everything, composition, everything. He may not be able to cover the whole in 1 or 2 hours, but then he will give you a good picture of the gospel of Matthew to understand the gospel. Not only understand the gospel, also to understand the person of Matthew, as we see in Matthew 9, chapter 9, during his call by Jesus Christ. So at this moment, I am very pleased to welcome, also introduce to you all. Our speaker of today is Father Naveen Rebello. He is a Divine Word Missionary, SVD, Divine Word Missionary, from Mumbai province, India, Mumbai province. But he was born in Mangalore, Karnataka. After his initial studies, he went to Rome for his licentiate in Biblical Institute, and also now he also obtained a diploma in Hebrew language in the Hebrew University, Jerusalem. After that, he started pursuing his doctoral studies in the Biblical Institute in Matthew's Gospel of Matthew. In fact, he is a professor of Jnanadeepa Pune, a Pune seminary, we can call him a pontifical seminary, and also in many other study centers in India, and also in Rome, there is a Chandravad Janthas, that is center, Nemi, he is also visiting professor. And another positive element of his scholarship is that he can also handle biblical languages, Hebrew, Greek, and also Latin. So this person now, Father Naveen, is in Rome doing his doctoral studies, but now he gives us this lecture from Rome, and I welcome him again on behalf of everyone present here. Also will be coming here soon, those who are attending this course, and I bless everyone that you benefit from the richness of Father Naveen Rebello. And so the ball is on your court, Father Naveen. Yes.
Thank you, Bishop. Thank you for these words of welcome. And I also thank Father Yesu for this opportunity. So thank you very much, and I look forward to interact with your participants at the end of this session.
Excuse me 1 minute. I just want to also, I forgot to introduce to our participants or students the booklets on the Bible Correspondence course, which we are sending on online to all our participants here. But we also started sending by post, those who are registered by post, all the lessons. So now we have 4 lessons, starting from Introduction to the Bible, till the Pentateuch, and also other lessons will come. And there will be 20 lessons, or 24 lessons. 24 lessons in 2 years' time. So those who like to also benefit from this, or you can recommend this course to your companions or your interested people, that they can have also read. This is a little clearly is given, the text is given to you, and you can also ask people to benefit from here. So I'm happy to introduce these lessons to all our participants or students, and that you benefit from this, and you can get it from our CCBI Commission for Bible. You know the address, everything. You just write it is they can send it by post. So thank you. Continue, please continue.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Thank you. Thank you, Your Excellency, for your words of welcome to Father Naveen, and thanks also for officially releasing the books of the correspondence course. Now may I request Father Naveen to take over.
Yeah, thank you, Yesu. Thank you, Bishop, for the words of welcome. Yes, so we begin this session on Gospel according to Matthew. I would like to tell you right at the beginning, the purpose of this particular session or two sessions that we are going to have, not an interpretative, because we will not be able to cover the whole Gospel of Matthew, but kind of a introductory in nature. So I would like to place before you the context, the general context of the Gospel, the literary context of the Gospel. So when you read this first Gospel, when I say first Gospel according to the canon, you will be able to better understand Matthew, his Gospel and his theology. So if you take the Greek New Testament, you see this is the first page.
Naveen?
Of course, yes?
You may share your screen, Naveen.
Okay, one second, Yesu.
Yes, Naveen.
I use
Alt tab.
One second, I have put it on the tab. Is it coming?
Not yet.
One second. Is there so?
Not just open PowerPoint, Naveen. Slideshow. Then come with the Alt tab to Google Meet.
I opened the PowerPoint, Yesu. Alt tab. Okay.
Now share screen.
A present now. Window.
Yes, now.
One second. Now.
Window, select at PowerPoint.
Okay. Little confusion.
Okay, Naveen, I'll share from here. You start just that.
Okay, should I? Okay, fine.
Yes, you come back to your speaker view and you start, Naveen. I share from here.
Can you hear me, Yesu?
Yes, Naveen, we can hear you, we can see you. And you start talking.
Yeah, sure. Yesu, you will take care of the PowerPoint. I will just, from here, I will, with my PowerPoint, I will share, okay, my session. Dear friends, you can see, you have the page of the Greek New Testament there, the genealogy of Jesus Christ. It is written there, Kata Matthaion. Now, the meaning of that is according to Matthew. So, in other words, it is not written the Gospel according to Matthew. It's just about according to Matthew. And this title, according to the scholars who say that it was added only somewhere after 100 AD or say 150 AD. And therefore, it could have been that the Gospel of Matthew was written before 100 AD, and the title was there. And we find in the Greek New Testament, though, as Bishop said, Mark's Gospel was written first, but It is placed in the canon of the New Testament as the first gospel. And therefore, I may say sometimes first gospel, it does not refer to Mark in terms of scholarship, but in terms of the canon. But in terms of the canon, you can see that the gospel of Matthew is the first gospel. Now, the meaning of the word meaning of Matthew is Mattai, or from the Aramaic, Matanyahu, which means the gift of Yahweh, the gift of Yahweh. With regard to the authorship, we find that from the second century, due to the church tradition, the first gospel was attributed to Matthew, the tax collector from Capernaum, and the apostle of Jesus. As Father Yesu read in the introductory prayer, the calling of Matthew. Now, the designation of Matthew as a tax collector is not found in the other two Gospels of the Synoptics, that is in, say, in Mark or Luke, and there's also a list in the Acts of the Apostles where the designation Matthew as the tax collector is not given. The tax collector from Capernaum, according to Mark and Luke, is simply named as Levi, but it is only the Gospel of Matthew which makes this connection that Matthew was Levi, or Levi was Matthew. So how do we understand that, whether it was Matthew who wrote the first gospel, or who wrote, Levi or the tax collector? And therefore, we fall back to the testimony which Bishop mentioned, the testimony of Papias, which is in the next slide, which shows Matthew wrote the oracles, in Greek, the Theologia, in Hebrew language, the Hebraidi dialectoi, and everyone interpreted them as he was able. Now, this particular testimony of Papias was quoted by Eusebius, that was in his book History of the Church, but much later in the 4th century. But this particular testimony of Papias, that Matthew wrote the first gospel, was taken up later by Irenaeus and Tertullian and Origen, as I have shown you, in a chronological way. So all these fathers of the church understood that, based on the testimony of Papias, that the first gospel was written by Matthew. Now, in terms of the modern scholarship, there is no indication about the author or the place of the origin within the gospel. For that matter, even John's gospel, which calls as a beloved disciple, or Luke's gospel, they do not, in fact, give their names within the gospel, or with regard to for Mark. So none of these gospels speak about the authors or the date or the place within the gospel itself. What we find when we study the gospel in detail, that the gospel of Matthew, also like Luke and John, it reflects a later period in the church history. I will come back to some of those elements within the gospel. Secondly, the gospel also makes use of another gospel written by a non-apostle. Interestingly, the question is, say, if we consider Matthew as an apostle of Jesus Christ, and if he had seen Jesus' life, Jesus' passion, death, and resurrection, then why did he depend on Mark, who was a non-witness to the gospel, in the sense, non-witness to Jesus? Because Mark seemed to have received his traditions, his accounts, from Peter, who was the eyewitness for Jesus' life. So it's very interesting that why did Matthew depend on Mark, who was not a witness to Jesus' life? On the other hand, we also find that Matthew's gospel is not an eyewitness account. It does not tell that Jesus got up in the morning, that Jesus did all these things during the day, and then Jesus went to bed. It is not on a daily basis. The purpose of the Gospels is different, to present Jesus, especially the Gospel according to Matthew, to present Jesus as the Messiah of Israel. And also, Papias would say that it could have been translated from Hebrew or Aramaic, Semitic languages. But if Matthew, according to the modern scholarship, if Matthew dependent on Mark, because I'm sure that you studied in your previous class, the synoptic problem, that the synoptic, two other synoptic gospels, Matthew and Luke, they took their primary source was Mark, and also hypothetical source called Q, or the saints. So interestingly, why, if Matthew had taken from Mark, which is written in Greek, why should Matthew, there was no need for Matthew to be written in Aramaic and Hebrew. So in other words, the simple logic is that Matthew wrote his gospel in Greek, having Mark and Q as his primary sources. The next point that I would like to mention with regard to the authorship, that Matthew was a Christian theologian. He wanted to speak about Christ, to tell the story of Jesus to his audience, to his community. And one of the interesting things that we find, immediately we finish the Old Testament with the book of Prophet Malachi, we begin with the New Testament, and the first book, the first gospel is Matthew, which deals so much about the Old Testament with regard to the Hebrew scripture or the Septuagint, the Old Testament. You will find amount of so many quotations from the Old Testament, and therefore it's a beautiful bridge. The Matthew's gospel becomes a wonderful bridge between the Old Testament, New Testament, because as you begin the New Testament, in fact, it speaks about the genealogy of Jesus, Jesus' ancestors. It's in fact a condensed history of Israel, and therefore it beautifully links or gives a bridge to the readers as they enter the New Testament. Within the Gospel of Matthew, we find a very beautiful text that it says that every scribe who has been trained, or you can translate, every scribe who has been discipled for the kingdom of heaven is like a householder who brings out his treasure, what is new and what is old. So in other words, throughout this gospel, we find that Matthew brings out the old things, but then he gives a kind of a new wine, we say novelty. And that novelty is Jesus Christ. So in other words, Matthew's audience was a Jewish Christian audience, Greek speaking. So he brings the context of the Old Testament, something that is old, but then he also places Jesus within that context of Israel old. And therefore, Matthew, as a good scribe, as an evangelist, brings both old and new out of his treasure and presents to his community. And therefore, you will find throughout the gospel, there's a tension between the old and the new. No, very often when we too, sometimes when there are changes, there is newness, we also resist. And this is actually Matthew wants to tell, that Jesus came with the good news of newness, novelty, but people resisted. People wanted to maintain the status quo of the covenant or the laws, the traditions. And that's what Matthew is trying to present in his gospel. So this is something that I can tell you in terms of authorship, that Matthew was a Christian theologian who wrote with the conviction that Jesus was the Messiah of Israel. The date, now when did the Gospel of Matthew, when did Matthew write his Gospel? Now, nobody can definitively say, because now we are distanced. There's a kind of a chronological, temporal distance. We are in the 21st century and we are studying a book which was written in the first century. So none of us can definitively say, because there is no date given within the gospel, that it was written in such a such date. We can only look at certain elements within the gospel and come to some kind of a suggestive date. And therefore the suggestive date that the scholars have given, that it could have been written somewhere possibly between 80 to 85 AD. Now, what is the main reason? Now, Mark's gospel was written before the destruction of the temple of Jerusalem and the city of Jerusalem in 70 AD by the Romans. If Mark was the source text for Matthew, so it could have been written sometime later. And therefore, certain elements within the gospel of Matthew shows that that particular gospel was written after the destruction of the temple. And also when the early Christians were expelled from the synagogues of the Jewish people, this gospel was written in, as a response, in order to comfort and encourage them. And therefore you will find within Matthew 22:7, I have mentioned that the king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed these murderers and burned the city. So some scholars say this could be an allusion to the destruction of the temple and the city of Jerusalem. Though it comes from the parable, the author of the Matthew's gospel, the evangelist was aware, and perhaps that formed this background for that. And therefore, knowing well the hostility that was there, and also kind of destruction of the temple, we can say that the gospel must have been written somewhere later between 80 to 85. And this is only a suggestive date. Okay, we go quickly to the next point, that is the place of the gospel. Where was the gospel came to be written? The scholars say that most likely it was written in the Syrian city of Antioch. Why? Because Ignatius of Antioch is the first one to make use of the gospel of Matthew in his writing. Now you see Ignatius of Antioch, he was the father of the church. He was writing letters, he was writing documents. And while he was writing, he made use of the Gospel of Matthew. And this is the earliest usage of the Gospel of Matthew by this particular father of the church. So people say that perhaps this gospel was written in Antioch. Moreover, the gospel also has a lot of features of the Jewishness. And Antioch seemed to had a Jewish Christian population which spoke Greek. And that fits well because Matthew's gospel was written in Greek. And then it was written for the Jewish Christians who spoke Greek, and also made use by a person who was living in Antioch, Ignatius of Antioch, and therefore it could have been written in Antioch. So this is just the, of course, there are other suggestions that are given, but then we stick to this particular place, that Antioch, most likely the place where the Gospel of Matthew was written, because there was a community which spoke in Greek, Jewish Christians, and Ignatius of Antioch made use of the Gospel of Matthew in his writings. Now, the another point that I would like to share with you is the who are the audience, or who is the audience of Matthew's Gospel. So we, especially the Gospel according to Matthew, as I said, it was written for the Jewish Christian, but it was those who were speaking Greek, and therefore Matthew's Gospel may not have been written in Hebrew and Aramaic. Now, throughout this gospel, we find that Matthew speaks about the relationship between the Jewish Christians and Jewish brothers. Now, what happened was, after the destruction of the temple in 70 AD, okay, many of the groups, Jewish groups, say, for example, Zealots, Sadducees, the priestly class, all these groups came to be destroyed. The only group that remained was the Pharisee group, or the so-called the group that came to be known as the Rabbinic Judaism. And they wanted to once again begin a kind of a Judaism, which is called formative Judaism. Now, one side, Judaism was taking a reshape, a rebirth, but on the other end, Matthew's community also was taking a shape, was growing or being born. So there was a kind of a tension between both these communities. And therefore, I said that many of the followers of Jesus were expelled from the synagogue, and therefore you will find many references within the gospel that speak about their synagogues. Already there is some kind of a, as is given here, in conflict, my church against their synagogue. You will find reference in 4:23, 9:35. And therefore we find that this particular community, Christian community of Matthew, was a persecuted community, a divided community, and was in conflict with Judaism. Moreover, within the Matthean community or Matthew's community, there was a kind of a transition. Primarily, there were only Jewish Christians, but eventually Gentiles who heard the good news of Jesus were also getting converted and becoming part of the Matthew's community. And therefore, we can also say that it was a community in transition with Jewish and Gentiles coming together and living together. Now, these are some of the introductory issues that I have taken up. Now, I would like to go directly into the Gospel of Matthew. So before we begin, I would like to share with you some of the characteristics of this gospel. Now, Gospel of Matthew was used often in the early church, and therefore, according to the tradition, because of his importance was so much that once even Saint Augustine said, if you read the Gospel of Matthew, you need not read the Gospel of Mark. In other words, what he intended to say is that the Gospel of Matthew had 28 chapters. Mark has only 16 chapters. So Augustine was hinting, if you have read the whole Gospel of Matthew with 28 chapters, all that Mark wants to say is that already being summarized in the Gospel of Matthew. However, Augustine was not aware of what the modern scholars say today, that Mark was written prior to Matthew. But the way he looked chronologically, he said, Matthew's gospel is so important. All that you need to know about Jesus Christ has been written by this scribe in this particular gospel. And it is also the most quoted gospel. So if you take the writings of the fathers of the church, very often you find that Matthew, the gospel of Matthew being quoted. And that's why before this session began, some of you perhaps locked in later, Bishop was telling that it was the gospel of the church. Because the word ecclesia occurs only in the Gospel of Matthew. And it was considered literally the gospel of the church because it was being quoted, made use of in its catechesis, in its doctrinal formulations, and especially with regard to the papal authority, because upon this rock I will build my church, Matthew chapter 16 following Jesus' promise to Peter, only found in the Gospel of Matthew. And therefore, it became a very important gospel or a document for the church. Moreover, Matthew's gospel is also known as the teaching gospel, because within this gospel, you will find five discourses of Jesus. I will explain to you. And very importantly, the Gospel of Matthew ends with this great commission to the disciples. Go, make disciples of the nations and teach them. And teach them, very important key verb, teach them. Now, what is the meaning of teaching? What should the disciples now who are going out as disciples, apostles should teach? So Matthew already prepares in his gospel the five teaching discourses, five set of teaching. And therefore, what the disciples are supposed to teach, what Jesus has taught in these five blocks of teaching. And these teachings I will, one by one, I'll explain to you. And these five discourses, the Sermon on the Mount, then you have the missionary discourse in chapter 10, the parable discourse, the community discourse, and the eschatological discourse. These five discourses are the teaching. You will not find... you will find these teachings in both in Mark and Luke, but they are not organized in the way Matthew has organized. So when you take the Gospel of Matthew, you can immediately say, these are the teachings of Jesus. These are the miracles of Jesus. So well crafted by genius Matthew in five sets of five blocks of teaching. Another important characteristics of Matthew's gospel, it is known as the fulfillment gospel, because Jesus is presented as the fulfillment of the scripture. So you will find certain fulfillment quotation, and there's a kind of a formula that precedes this fulfillment quotation. It says, and it came to take place, what was spoken, what was written by the prophet, or what was written in the scripture, or what was spoken, and that came to fulfill. So therefore, whatever Jesus speaks or does, or even the very birth of Jesus, no? You will find the first quotation in one chapter 1, verse 23. The very birth of Jesus has been already told by the prophets. So you will find Jesus as the fulfillment of the scripture. What are some of the unique texts of Matthew's gospel? What are some of the uniqueness of Matthew? Firstly, in Matthew's gospel, you do not find the ascension. Jesus does not ascend to heaven. That does not mean that Jesus did not ascend to heaven, where Mark, Luke, John, or Acts of the Apostles, they do make a mention. But Matthew's gospel just ends with saying that, I am with you till the end of ages. In other words, Matthew wants to tell his audience that even though Jesus has ascended, which means he knows, his community knows that Jesus is not physically present, but Jesus is God with us, Emmanuel is. And that's why Matthew's gospel is also known as the gospel of God's presence. You will find in the first chapter, 1:23, where the evangelist says, Jesus is Emmanuel. Emmanuel means God with us. And at the end of the gospel, he comes back to that saying that, I will be with you till the end of the ages. So the gospel scholars say that it's a kind of an inclusio. Like it brackets, the whole gospel is bracketed by the divine presence. And there is something within the gospel itself. If you take 18:20, which says, when two or three are gathered in my name, I am there in your midst. I am there in your midst. Again, Jesus is promising his presence in the community of the disciples. Thirdly, only in the gospel of Matthew you find the Trinitarian formula. Now, it does not mean that the Trinity itself, the persons of the Trinity are not present in the other gospel. They do in every gospel, especially in John's gospel. But only Matthew uses the term in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. at the end of his gospel. So this Trinitarian formula is found in Matthew's gospel. Then I said it is unique gospel because also it's called the teaching gospel. Jesus is presented in a typological way as the new Moses. So Moses was the one who gave the law. Jesus is the new Moses who gives the new law to the new Israel, which is church. And therefore, this gospel is also known as the gospel of the church. As I said, the Greek word for the church is ecclesia, which signifies the community of the believers. And you will find these reference to ecclesia in chapter 16, 18 or 18, 17. And therefore, church is presented as someone as the new and true Israel in the context of the Israel. We have some other themes that are very prominent in the Gospel of Matthew is the kingdom of God. Or Matthew does not use the word kingdom of, he does use, but prominently uses the word kingdom of heaven. The word basileia means kingdom is used 55 times. Basileia ton uranon, kingdom of heaven, 32 times. But kingdom of God, basileia tou theou, is used only 4 times. Now, why did Matthew use the word kingdom of heaven and not kingdom of God? There is no consensus among the scholars, but most of them suggest that perhaps evangelist was a Jewish Christian. And you know the commandment, do not take the name of God in vain. And therefore, instead of saying kingdom of God or kingdom of Yahweh, kingdom of the Lord, Matthew, being sensitive to the Jewish sentiments, especially because of the law and the commandment, would have thought of, instead of mentioning the name, he would use the realm, the divine realm where God actually resided and reigned. God rules from heaven. And therefore, he chose to mention as kingdom of heaven, not to break the commandment of law or misusing the name of God. Some others say the very kingdom that Jesus uses has its origin in heaven because God reigns in heaven and it is being realized on earth. So there is the heavenly origin of the kingdom. And therefore, perhaps the word kingdom of heaven is used. As I said, gospel of fulfillment, I gave you 122. This is the formula that is used. All this took place to fulfill what has been spoken by the prophet. No, this is the fulfillment. And I have given there on the page, these are the quotations that are formulas that are used. And followed by these formula, the fulfillment quotations are used. Another important theme in the Gospel of Matthew, which we can see in the next slide, is the theme of universalism. Now, I told you there was some kind of a conflict between Jesus' community, sorry, Matthew's community, which is Jewish Christians, and outside, the Jewish brothers. But then Matthew's community is also open to the Gentiles. And therefore, we can see, say, particularism. Particularism means I, me, my people, only Israel. But Matthew's gospel, though there were Jewish people, Jewish Christian, it is open to the Gentiles. Though we find that before Jesus' death and resurrection, Jesus' ministry was mainly for the Israel. Because Jesus himself tells only to the lost sheep of Israel. But then Jesus' ministry after resurrection, which is continued by his disciples, is meant for the nations. The word that is used is ethne, go out to the nation. Jesus says, go make disciples of the nation. Therefore, Jesus has a very clear picture in mind. He prepares Israel. He prepares his disciples so that they have a role. They have a function to go out and bring others to Jesus. But there are already within the gospel, there are glimpses. There are glimpses of the inclusion of the Gentiles. To give you one beautiful example, in the very genealogy of Jesus, there are Gentile people who are included. I have mentioned especially women, Tamar, Rahab, Ruth, wife of Uriah. Now, these are considered by their origin Gentile people, and moreover being women, they are part of Jesus' genealogy. In other words, you can say Jesus chose to be born in a family in which ancestry or in family there were both Jews and the Gentiles. We have the much celebrated passage of the, say, the feast of the Epiphany, the Gentile Magi. You find only in the Gospel of Matthew. No other gospel gives this kind of an opening since it comes in chapter 2. No other gospel except Matthew, which gives us such a beautiful opening and inclusion of the Gentiles right from the beginning of the gospel. We also find Jesus and the centurion, Jesus and the Canaanite woman. And at the end of the gospel, Jesus is sending his disciples out to the nation. So you'll find that the theme of universalism is very much underscored or emphasized by Matthew in his gospel. We shall move to the next text, which this I need not explain because it is, as I mentioned, Matthew has organized 5 major discourses in his gospel, something that is beautiful. I'll mention these 5 and then I'll give you the structure of the gospel. Sermon on the Mount, chapter 5-7, which speaks about Jesus' kingdom manifesto. Then you have mission discourse in 10. Now it speaks about what is the disciples' kingdom mission, not only about Jesus, but the disciples are sent. So mission discourse. Then comes the parable discourse, that Jesus' story, the stories that were told by Jesus are put together by Matthew, which speaks about the dual nature of the kingdom, that God's kingdom has already been realized in Jesus, but it is not fully realized. So you need to wait. And then we have in chapter 18, there's a community discourse, how community on earth embodies the reign of God or the kingdom of God. And finally, the eschatological discourse, that is in the context of Israel, how the temple is going to fall and the kingdom of God will be finally realized, or people can actually feel that that Jesus is the true Messiah, that who has come. So you will find that these 5 discourses. Then there are some narratives which are very unique to Matthew, which you don't find in other gospel, which we have it in the next scene. The dream of Joseph, that Joseph is a dreamer. This is the year of Joseph. Now, very often Joseph is presented as a dreamer. You will not find in any other gospel, only in Matthew. Visit of the Magi, the flight to Egypt, the massacre of the innocents in Bethlehem, the suicide of Judas, the dream of Pilate's wife, the false report of the guards after Jesus' resurrection. All these passages, all these pericopes texts are very unique to Matthew. And when it comes to the teaching of Jesus, there are so many parables which are very unique to Matthew. For example, parable of the weeds, treasure and pearl, unforgiving servant, laborers in the vineyard, 2 sons, 10 virgins, the judgment of the nations, all these parables are very unique to Matthew, which are not found in the other gospel. And if you want to know what Matthew wants to speak, what Matthew wants to articulate and communicate, we need to read these parables, and we will find the true intention, the theology of the Gospel of Matthew. Now we move to the structure of the Gospel of Matthew. It is very simple that I just explained. It speaks about how did Matthew actually get his resources, no sources to write. Where you see in little gray areas, like say 3, 4, 8, 9, 11, 12, 14, 17, 19, 20, 26, 7, most of this material deal with the narrative about the life of Jesus, not about the teaching of Jesus. So most likely this teaching, which is little gray area, 3, 4, 8, 9, 11, 12, 14, 7, 19, 20, 26. These might have come from Mark. Okay. And then you see here 5, 7, 10, 13, 18, and 23, 25, which I mentioned as the 5 discourses of the Gospel of Matthew. These teachings might have been from the so-called the Q source, which also shared by Luke. But Luke puts it differently, whereas Matthew arranges in this way. Now, something that we go to the next slide, where we find that there is something very special in the Gospel of Matthew. He repeats a particular formula 5 times. He says, and when Jesus finished this saying, the crowds were astonished at his teaching. And again, he says, and when Jesus finished instructing, and when Jesus had finished these parables, now when Jesus had finished these sayings, and again, when Jesus had finished all these sayings. So these 5 sayings, this particular 5-fold formula is repeated, and therefore, it made a particular scholar who was called Bacon to say that the Gospel of Matthew, you can see that formula is repeated in 7:28. So he said, what preceded this formula is Jesus' teaching. Means Jesus teaches something, and immediately once Jesus finished teaching, that the evangelist says, and now when Jesus finished saying this, and therefore he said that the Gospel of Matthew is classified or categorized into 5 books. As you can see that book 1, book 2, book 3, and then the next step, next slide, book 4, book 5. I'm sure that it is also part of the notes that is given to you. So I'm not going to explain. But what is the most important thing you notice that Matthew was, I said, a Jewish Christian theologian, was writing to the Jewish Christian community. And you know that they considered the Old Testament as their Bible. And the most important book for them, the most important section of the Old Testament was Torah, the Pentateuch. And Pentateuch had 5 books, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and the Deuteronomy. So this Benjamin Bacon compares these 5 books of Matthew to the Pentateuch. So Matthew might have it in his mind that when he was trying to depict Jesus or speak about Jesus, he compared him to the 5 books. So the 5 blocks of teaching in Matthew corresponds to the 5 books of the Old Testament. We move to the next point. Then there is something called twofold formula, which is given in the following section. There's another formula. Some other scholars say, well, Matthew's gospel is not merely a book. Matthew's gospel is a narrative. It's a story of Jesus. So you cannot divide the gospel into book, but you must look the gospel as a kind of a story or narrative. And therefore he says, the scholar Kingsbury, who says, from that time Jesus began to preach, saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And then this formula is repeated again. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples. Now, what we go to the next slide. Now, what Benjamin Bacon is saying, look at that formula, that in 4:16, the formula there, which makes the division between the first part and the second part. So the first part deals with the Jesus' infancy and Jesus' pre-ministry scenes like baptism, temptation. But with this formula, Jesus begins his kingdom ministry. And this formula is repeated in, say, I said 16:21, where Jesus begins his next part of his journey to Jerusalem. So he says, like in every story, I'm sure that some of you watch some films. So whenever you watch that film, there are 3 parts. There is something called a beginning, middle, and an end. So when you have a beginning, you must have an end. And what begins should also flow before it should reach the end. And therefore, Kingsbury says there is something called narrative beginning. Then there is something called the narrative corpus, or the narrative body of the gospel, where Jesus does his public ministry. And from 16:21, that verse divides, because now is Jesus going to Jerusalem, where he will embrace cross and God will raise him up. And therefore say the gospel is indeed divided into these 3 parts. Now we move to the first part, the infancy narrative. Now I'm sure that all of you have read these stories of Jesus and you're very familiar. So I'm not going to explain these stories at all. But the first two, only the Gospel of Matthew and the Gospel of Luke have these infancy narratives. John and Mark do not have. Now, something very special to Mark, that special to Matthew, he in fact answers 4 questions. Who is Jesus? How is Jesus born? Where is Jesus born? And then from where does Jesus come? Okay, now, in order to answer who is Jesus, he gives the genealogy. So who is Jesus? So Jesus is a Jew born in the family of Abraham according to the lineage of David. So this is being mentioned in the who of Jesus. So condensed history of Israel is being presented in the genealogy. The second question is how this messianic Jesus is born. He is not born like me and you or any other king of the genealogy. He is born through a miraculous way. Therefore, you have the virginal conception. How Jesus is born, how this Jesus came into this world. The third is where Jesus is born. And therefore, chapter 2 begins with saying that Jesus was born in Bethlehem, the city of David, during the reign of Herod. See, it gives a very important, precise historical date. Therefore, Jesus' birth is not a myth. that many other, say, in many other myths and legends you have, so and so is born. But be it Jesus' birth, that Jesus was born in that during the reign of Herod, or Jesus' death, which we profess in the creed, that Jesus died during the, say, during the pontificate or during the reign of Pontius Pilate or under the Pontius Pilate. So these historical figures' names are given so that Jesus' birth, life, and death becomes a historical reality, historic signpost to the readers. And thirdly, and to this Bethlehem, the Magi from the East come. So they come and worship Jesus as the Messianic King, which fulfills the so-called the dynasty of David. And then finally, the last point that I want to see is that Jesus, say at the end of the infancy story, that Jesus and his family settled down in Nazareth. Now, this is very important because the question is raised, though Jesus was born in Bethlehem, why Jesus is called Jesus of Nazareth? Now, everyone calls Jesus of, not Jesus of Bethlehem, but Jesus of Nazareth. And therefore, the author wanted to tell that though Jesus was born, after some years in his initial years, he settled down in Nazareth. The Holy Family was rooted in Nazareth. And therefore, it is true that when Jesus comes for baptism, he's called Jesus of Nazareth. Okay, I think Father Isu informed me that it is first session ends with this 45 minutes. So I just conclude the first session and then maybe after the break, we come to the second session. Thank you.
Okay, Navin.
Hi, Isu. Yeah.
Yes, Navin. We'll take a break. It's 4:57. We'll come again at
5:07. Yeah, sure. Okay. Whenever I will be just here, I'll just mute the video on the audio. Okay,
Navin. Okay, thank you. So, good evening. How are you all?
Good evening, Father. Nice to see you.
Oh,
Father. Thank you.
Good evening, Father.
Good evening to you. How are you all?
We are fine, Father. How are you?
Fine, thank you. Super. How do you feel today's class? Good?
Very nice.
very nicely explained.
He's really yes. Good. He's very good and very rarely people do doctorate at Biblicum and he's doing that. And we were companions together for licensure.
Oh, very good, Father. Very good presentation.
Father, he's from Mangalore, right? If I'm not mistaken.
He's from Mangalore. He's from Mangalore.
Yes, I have heard him before. Only once I heard it, but I really enjoyed his speaking like that.
Oh, great.
He spoke about the passion of Jesus in Atma Darpa, Mumbai.
Ah, yeah, I think so. Yeah, he was there.
He's a SVD, I'm not sure.
He's an SVD priest.
Yes, when I saw him, I realized.
Yes.
This was one of the best lectures, Father. One of the best lectures.
Yes, sure. He does well.
And Father, your presence has made such a difference to this course, Father. I'm glad that you have come in. Really well.
Thank you, sir. Thank
you're
you.
Such a, I am not flattering you, Father. You're such an humble and nice priest, Father. I really enjoy communicating.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
I think, Father, you should go for a break now.
No problem. And I just want to communicate to you that all the videos of our lessons have been posted in our YouTube channel and you can have a look at them. So if you type in the YouTube channel, St. Paul Online Bible College, you will go to the channel and you may get all the videos.
Father, some were missing. That also is there now.
Yes, yes, videos. I have put all.
Like, I think yes.
Thank you, Father, for uploading.
But now yeah, I'm there.
Lessons 9 till 9th lesson were there. Videos were there. I have added 4 more.
Acha. Yes. But between 1 and 9, I believe some video was missing. I'm not sure which lecture.
I see. I'll check in the list.
It's okay, Father. That time you were not there. So
I was not there.
No, I'm just saying out of my mind.
Okay, good. Thank you. We have our Hebrew course also going on. And 6 have signed up. And those videos are also there. Hebrew tutorials. If you'd like to follow, you could follow. Okay.
You put it on the group, Father, on the channel, is it?
Send it on the group, Father, Hebrew lessons. Yeah.
It's on the same for Bible College kind of thing.
St. Paul Bible College is conducting Hebrew
yeah.
course.
Yeah, Father, we got that message.
Yes.
But Father, we could not drive for your course in the morning, Father, but we have
okay, maybe we'll see.
Our full classes, my lectures were clashing with your lecture, Father. But I'm glad that you have put it on the YouTube channel that I can watch it, Father.
Yes,
thank you so much.
Good. And you are doing well. Hello. Because all are writing the assessment well on time and sending, and very good. So keep them up. And some have completed all the 24 lessons, and I am working on the mark sheet for them. So I will communicate to them personally. Some are
can
very...
we have that correspondence notes, Father?
Yes, ma'am, we could send. Yeah. Actually, but this is meant for a correspondence course. Okay, though you are registered for it.
But we don't have this. So at least that I can get.
But I'll talk to the chairman and see what we can do.
Okay.
For the hard copies.
Hard copies are like we have 500 copies. And it's for the second, that's another course, the correspondence course. Little different, the assessment and all. Maybe I'll talk to the chairman and see whether we can send to the online students as well.
Okay.
That would be handy for us. I think.
Father, we don't mind paying for that also. If we can send it.
Okay.
Father, do we need to give our address, Father, or how is it?
You may have to give the addresses.
And we need to pay for the postal?
Maybe you could, mail me to our CCBI bible@gmail.com.
Okay, Father.
And I will put the mail ID.
We send our address on this, Father, what you put up now.
Pardon?
We send our address on the bible@gmail.com?
Yes, ma'am.
And then do we pay for the postal also, Father?
Okay. I'll clarify and let you know, because
please.
Our chairman says that we can give freely for those who are registered, no problem. And otherwise I'll see how what can be.
Otherwise paid option also is okay for them.
Maybe I'll see. Just the printing charges.
Yeah. We are registered students.
Yeah.
But Father, sure, we'll do the same notes which we are doing now, ours is little different, Father.
Yes, same notes. I mean, little addition, modification. Not much, but 5 to 10% changes will be.
Okay, extra. Okay, then I don't mind.
But also, it's good to have some hard copies, no? Like, you can always.
Yes, Father.
You can always just go back to refer and.
Yes, sir.
So, it all has the same format. So, it's Old Testament brown, New Testament blue, we have planned. So you could keep like a pack.
Father, if you just paid often, then you can let us know how much we have to.
Sure. I'll put in our website that I'll put an announcement there.
On the website. Okay.
Yes. I'll put an announcement there. Maybe you could see.
The WhatsApp group, if you can put Father better, because we don't go to the channel every now and then.
You can just text me to my office number, no? Then I will take it.
On the WhatsApp, say St. Paul Students Group, you can put this?
You can put there. No.
Okay.
You can put in the group, or you can just send your addresses to my office number, that is.
Okay. Excuse me.
You can send to this number. Okay. Good. Good. So Naveen, our students are very appreciative of you, and some seem to have known you when you were in Mumbai, no?
Oh, is that so? Thank you so much. Yes.
Thank you so much.
Oh yes, Sunil, I can see you. Thank you. Yes.
But I only heard one teaching of yours on the passion narratives you have done there.
Yes, I remember with Father Nazareth in Atmadarshan. Yes, thank you.
I've seen you after a long time. Nice to see you.
Yeah, nice meeting you too. Yeah, thank you. Thanks, Sunil.
And Father, despite your cold and have a sore throat, you are still doing your best, and we are grateful to you for that.
Yes, thank you so much. Yes, thank you so much.
I can make
in,
up,
In fact, I heard just overheard, like when I just entered. In fact, all that I'm saying now in this class, it is there in your notes. But because I wanted to present in one way, I gave this outline in this way, because I realized after reading the notes that I would not be able to complete the 30 pages that are sent to you in 2 hours. So I put it like a kind of a synchronic manner, like how it flows, like, no? So all the points that I'm going to mention, they are there in your notes, but presented in a little different way, which is helpful to me. And when you read, you will say, begin to appreciate, because the notes are like the gospel, beginning till the end. But I'm trying to put them in a, say, together in a condensed way, so that at the end of this lecture, you know the total framework of Matthew's gospel, no? So that's how I'm trying to present to you, yeah.
Thank you, Father.
Yeah.
Father, where are you based right now, Father?
I'm in Rome. I'm in our SPD Generalate. So I stay here and I do my studies, but it is the summer month. So the universities are closed, the libraries are closed. And I stay back in the house and do my studies. So, yeah, that's what I'm doing currently, yeah.
Okay, you are
today we are fortunate to have a direct voice from Rome.
Rome, yeah.
Already our university is now international, so like with the different time zones. And I are making and taking this international.
Yeah. Oh. In fact, I'm grateful to you because both of us are classmates in Rome many years ago when we did our licentiate. So I was also very today wonderful to see Yesu and interact, though we are in touch with on the WhatsApp and we speak. But today, yeah, it was nice to see his ministry with you for the church in India and what he's doing and all of us. The very fact that I can see that more than 73 people are now logged in, that many of you are interested in the Word of God, no? Most of you are interested in learning the Bible, sharing it with your family, and that's the beauty of it. And that's why, as Sunil mentioned, that was also my desire that we need to reach out to the lay people, and that's how we began these biblical seminars in Bombay. We conducted about 7 seminars on parables of Jesus, passion narrative of Jesus, infancy narrative of Jesus on the weekend, so that we deepen our understanding of the Bible. In fact, I taught for about 2 to 3 years in Pune. The deepening of the scripture came when I was teaching to my students, because they were the ones who asked very profound, sometimes very simple, but at times very reflective and profound questions. So listening to them, even it made me to reflect further and deepen my knowledge of the scripture. And that's something beautiful. And I'm grateful for this particular platform that when we teach something, that I am also a student, you're also a student, both of us learn. And that's the beauty of the scripture. I remember when we finished our studies in Biblicum, both myself and Yesu, one of the professors mentioned to us, at least in my class, that when you finish your studies in scripture, I'm saying now you will finish these 24 modules, you may think that you have mastered the Bible, you have mastered the word, but that should not be our attitude, but allow the word to master your life. That's the beauty of the scripture, because the scripture, as I said in the Gospel of Matthew, is like a treasure. Every time you go to the treasure, both old and the new, something that is old you knew, but there is something that is new that you did not know comes out of that treasure. And Matthew's gospel offers this particular insight, that the scripture gives you both the treasures, old as well as the new. So I'm grateful that I'm here with you this evening, though it is noon for me and for you it's evening, yeah?
Good night.
Good, so yes.
Here we go now, it's now 5:10. We'll go up to 5:50, Naveen.
So yes, sure, no
we
problem.
Collect some questions, and some questions will be coming in the comment box also. I will collect and keep from 5:50 to 5:57. Maybe we'll discuss the questions. Then finally, you would just bless us with your apostolic blessing from Rome.
Yeah, sure, you see. Yeah, good. Thank you,
Naveen.
Okay, good. Yeah, continue. Yes. Yes, can you put up the screen on the. Yes. So, dear brothers and sisters, I was sharing with you about the infancy narratives, how Matthew's gospel begins to answer these four questions: who of Jesus, how of Jesus, where of Jesus, and whence of Jesus. And Matthew's, the evangelist Matthew adds a lot of midrashic elements. Midrashic means a lot of interpretative elements in the light of the scripture. The star, say for example, star like in the book of Numbers, you will find it in the notes, spoke about the star of the Messiah that would come in the prophecy of the Balaam. There are so many elements, Egypt, or there are so many connections to the story of Moses. So Matthew, like a kind of a rabbi, he interprets Jesus' birth in the light of the Old Testament, the insights from the Old Testament. Another beautiful thing in the infancy narratives, there are so many titles which are attributed to Jesus. Unlike the other Gospels, Matthew right away introduces in the infancy narrative, whether it is the Christ, Messiah, Son of David, Son of Abraham, all these three titles come in the very first book, the very first verse, which we call Incipit or the beginning, the book of the origin of Jesus, the Christ, the Son of David, Son of Abraham. And then you find that Jesus is the fulfillment of Israel. Then Jesus' name, only Matthew's gospel says his name will be called Jesus. Of course, Luke also says, but then Matthew gives the explanation why he has to be called Jesus, because Jesus comes from the Hebrew name Yasha, which means for he will save his people from their sins. Now, the salvific aspect behind Jesus' name is mentioned by Matthew. And then he's a son of God to a virgin. Then the fulfillment of the prophecies. And then he mentions Emmanuel, God with us. Only Matthew's gospel mentions. And then the Magi come with an inquiry. Where is the King of the Jews? You find it in the gospel of Matthew, worshipped by the Gentiles. And then at his birth, he becomes a threat to Herod and then the religious establishment in Jerusalem. So you find all these beautiful elements in the infancy narrative of Jesus. So we go to the next slide, where briefly I will mention to you about the genealogy of Jesus Christ. So the first verse introduces who is Jesus, and then it gives Jesus' family tree. Now, it's beautifully, unlike any other, something that I want to mention, that this genealogy is also found in the Gospel of Luke. But then in the Gospel of Luke, that the evangelist goes back to Adam. But in the Gospel of Matthew, the evangelist goes back to Abraham, because I told you he was precisely writing to a Jewish audience. And Abraham was considered the founder of the Jewish faith or the founder of Israel, from whom the Israelites came. And therefore, for him, there are two important or key figures in the history of Israel. One is Abraham, who is the patriarch, the founder, and secondly, David, the dynasty, because David was like a man, like the heart of God, And he was the one who established, made Jerusalem both the political and religious capital of Israel. And therefore, these two key figures, and therefore you can find that from Abraham to David, and from David to the so-called the exile, because exile was one of the most important, because when the kings of Israel, people of Israel, did not live according to the covenant, people of Israel were sent into exile. So it was a kind of a watershed moment in the history of Israel. People thought that, well, God's covenantal promises died, but then God continues the so-called the family of Abraham and David, and we have Christ as the culmination, as the crescendo. We say the ultimate, the fulfillment is in Jesus Christ. So this is something beautiful. All that I want to say about genealogy in one sentence: genealogy is the condensed history of Israel, where Jesus is presented as the fulfillment or the culmination of that particular history. Okay. Now, in all the episodes of the infancy narrative, you will find these four elements. So it's very easy to read. Look for these elements. There's always in that story, there is a problem. Then there's a medium. Then there's a message that is given, and there's a prophetic fulfillment. Now, what is the problem? Mary is found with a child. Now, medium. What is the medium? Angel comes, and then he gives a message. No, she is pregnant because of the Holy Spirit. And then there is a prophetic fulfillment that this man is God with us. So you take the story of Magi, there's a problem, because Jesus is born during the time of Herod, who is in fact a king who doesn't want to see another king as a threat. The medium is the star. The message given is, well, he is born in Bethlehem and he will be the leader, the shepherd of Israel. And that prophetic fulfillment comes to given that particular fulfillment. So in every story, you find these common elements. One or two elements may be missing, but then most elements are being present. And then the second chapter is something that is beautiful. As I said, there's a visit of Magi, escape to Egypt, massacre of the infants, return from Egypt. I mentioned these four things here because there's a stark contrast between Luke's infancy narrative and Matthew's infancy narrative. And this is something very important you should notice. Luke's gospel, infancy narrative, is full of joy, glory to God in the highest. Mary sings Magnificat, and then Zechariah sings Benedictus. Everything is very happy, joyful, very positive vibes. No, the shepherds dancing, going to Bethlehem. This gospel is read on the night of the Christmas night. But look at the Matthew's gospel. It all starts with violence. There is a king who wants to eliminate. And immediately the family become refugees. They are thrown out of their land. They have to run away from their land. Then the massacre of the infant, the blood is shed. And then this particular family, which was displaced from their land, had to go to Egypt. They returned to the land. And therefore, the language of the infancy narrative of Matthew is different from Luke. This more of negativity, violence. Yet God is the one who directs the history. In all these events, even though Herod wanted to eliminate, finally he gets eliminated and the child remains alive. That's the beauty of Matthew's story. Matthew wants to tell that the history of Israel is firmly guided and directed by God. And the shepherds don't appear. Therefore, what we do is that during the Christmas, we make a crib of both Matthew and Luke. You know, in Matthew, there are no shepherds. And in the Luke, there are no magi. But then we make a crib of both these infancy narrative put together. But I mention here because so that you will able to understand the differences of these authors. Okay, so the next two slides you can later read. It's very about the Magi, who are the Gentiles who came. I've just put there. And these are the Magi who saw the star and they recognized Jesus. No? So I wanted to mention to you is what is the message? That Jesus is rejected by the Jews because the Jewish people had the scriptures. They had the priest to tell, to interpret the scriptures. But Jesus is accepted by the Gentiles who just saw a sign in the star and they follow. They took risk. So something that is beautiful for us also, if you ask me what is the significance of this story, there are so many signs around us that God is directing our destiny. The fact that in this pandemic we are alive, and some of our family members or others whom we knew are not alive, itself is God's grace. The God is directing our life, is protecting and safeguarding us. And that's something beautiful that you find. These Gentile Magi are led by God's divine guidance and providence to the child. Okay. So the next point that I would like to highlight is before Jesus begins his ministry, there are some key episodes which we should not miss. The first is John the Baptist comes into the picture. Unlike Luke's gospel, where John's birth is given, in Matthew's gospel, he's silent about how John the Baptist is born, about his parents. But he presents John as a precursor, as a voice crying in the wilderness. And therefore, there's an author called John Meyer. Looking at the Jesus and John the Baptist relationship, he divides the gospel in this way. John the Baptist without Jesus, Jesus with John or John with Jesus, and then Jesus without John. In other words, simply I put John without Jesus, John with Jesus, Jesus without John. So the first part is John the Baptist in the desert. Jesus is not there. He's speaking about the kingdom. And the baptism of John was meant for repentance, whereas Jesus' baptism is the baptism of the Spirit. And then we have the baptism of Jesus. Jesus comes to the river Jordan. That's the only time these two people are together, John the Baptist and Jesus. And there we have the heavens opening, the Spirit empowering Jesus for his messianic ministry with the proclamation, declaration, you are the beloved. Now, he is my, very interesting in the Matthew's gospel, God does not say, you are my beloved son. He says, this is my beloved son. So it's very interesting that God is declaring Jesus in front of the world. Whereas in Luke and Mark's gospel, he says, "You are my beloved son." In other words, God is speaking to Jesus. But in Matthew's gospel, there's a little difference. He says, "This is my beloved son." So when he says, "This is my beloved son," God is inaugurating a new age, what we call the eschatological age or the messianic age in Jesus by introducing Jesus to the world. Just before we began this session, Bishop introduced me saying, "This is Father Naveen." So it means he was introducing me to you. So here we find in the gospel, God is introducing Jesus. Unlike Mark and Luke, God is talking to Jesus. "You are my beloved son." So there's a universal aspect that comes. The first character, and there's a non-human character, who wrongly understands that Jesus' messiahship is devil. And therefore, this devil, after Jesus' baptism, takes him to the desert and there challenges his messiahship. Jesus' messiahship is one that of suffering and cross. But then Satan misconstrues this messiahship as one that of being glorious messiah. And therefore you find a contrast between what God is saying, "You are my beloved son." And devil says, "If you are the son of God, then do this." But Jesus is faithful to his father and his will. And then there's a rebuttal of the Satan's temptation by the use of the scripture from the book of Deuteronomy. Very important, it is taken from the Deuteronomy because all these three quotations tell us that Israel was unfaithful and disobedient to God in the wilderness during the Exodus journey. Unlike Israel, Jesus is obedient to his father even though he's hungry and fasting for 40 days in the wilderness. So you can see Jesus as a representative of Israel. What Israel did not do or disobeyed, now Jesus replaces, changes, transforms through his very being in the desert. That is something that we find. The next slide will show you. In the gospel, you will find the first block of teaching called the Sermon on the Mount. Now, if you ask me, what is the Sermon on the Mount? Because there were so many historical personality and one from India, Mahatma Gandhi, was so much inspired by this particular teaching, no? Sermon on the Mount. It is basically, what is it if you ask me? It's a manual of Christian discipleship. Any of us, if you want to read about what our Christian, what is the essence of our Christian discipleship, read the Sermon on the Mount because it speaks to us the very essence of Jesus' teaching. And it contains the issues with regard to who is a disciple, disciples' identity. What is the new lifestyle a disciple should have? Our relationship with God and our relationship with others and the material world. Okay, what are the three types of materials that are used? We find in the next slide. Firstly, you will find the Beatitudes. I'm sure that all of you have read the Beatitudes. The Sermon on the Mount begins with the Beatitudes. Then there are certain ethical instructions are given. Do not hate your enemy. Don't do this one. Rather, you do. And then finally, that Jesus is giving a kind of a new law in contrast. In the past, it is said, but now I say to you. So Jesus is giving, Jesus radicalizes this law. No? That's why there's a beautiful quotation given by my own teacher. He has already passed away. He was teaching in Pune. He said, he summarized the Sermon on the Mount is like this. In the Sermon on the Mount, the law is internalized, simplified, and radicalized in such a way that it is no more law but love. No? I want you to later after this class, read this quotation, try to internalize, and then read the Sermon on the Mount, and you will see something, the newness of Jesus, he turns this. There is law, but how he approaches this law with the love of God and with the love of neighbor. And therefore, love summarizes everything in the Sermon on the Mount. The next slide will show, this is just like for your study, if you want to know how the Sermon on the Mount, three chapters, 5, 6, 7, are organized. So you can see that Jesus goes to the mountain. He sits there and opens his mouth. Now there are three important. Jesus going to the mountain. Who went to the mountain? Moses went to the mountain in the Old Testament. And then Jesus sits. Now sitting is a chair. In your cathedral, there is a chair of the bishop, which means authority. And then opening, Jesus opened his mouth. What in other words, it means Jesus started speaking revelatory words. In other words, the Sermon on the Mount begins with presenting Jesus as the new Moses with the authority of God speaking revelation. So what was in the Old Testament presented in a new way in Jesus. And then you have the Beatitudes and then the salt, to be the salt of the earth and the light of the world. Then there's an introduction to particular norms. You will find there are six antitheses which I mentioned. But in the entire sketch, what is given here, the most important thing is relationship with God. That's why I said the most important, the heart of the Sermon on the Mount is relationship with God. Look at, that's why the most important thing is God. Our relationship with humans or others, our relationship with the material things comes second. Therefore, you see the beauty of Matthew in the Sermon on the Mount, the core of our Christian discipleship are personal relationship with God. Everything else comes secondary. Your relationship with humans, your relationship with the material world, they are all secondary. And how this relationship with God is being shown with three particular acts, which we do it every Lenten season. Do you remember those three things? Three pillars of the Lenten season? This is what Jesus is trying to prayer, almsgiving, fast. And you find these three things in 6:1-18 when Jesus speaks about. And the core of this is the prayer, Our Father prayer, where Jesus introduces, where Jesus introduces his disciples that is not my Father, is my Father, yes, but it is our Father. So the communitarian dimension, you see the discipleship is already the formation of the, because you have a question later, the discipleship, the formation at the heart of discipleship is knowing that you are the child of God. And therefore, the formation of a discipleship is a process of knowing that you are a child of God. That is how Matthew begins to present. Just to give the narrative progression of the Sermon on the Mount, in the next slide, you will find there's a solemn introduction and then there's a Beatitudes that are blessed are the, I will just come later for this. Then there's a metaphor of salt and light. And then Jesus comes, the fulfillment of the law and the prophets, especially read chapter 5, verse 17. Now, many people thought that Jesus came to abolish the law, but Matthew says, no, Jesus did not come to abolish the law, but Jesus came to fulfill or perfect the law. It means Jesus is the best person. You can say he's the standard. What Jesus does is in accordance with the spirit of the law, not necessarily with the letter of the law, because Jesus always look to what was the intention of the law. And therefore, you will find in Jesus is the one who fulfills the law. And that's where it is given that Jesus fulfills the law and the prophets. And then we have something called six antitheses. And therefore, Gospel of Matthew is called the Gospel of Antitheses with regard to anger, adultery, divorce, oaths, retaliation, love for enemies. In your notes, it is beautifully given. You can see all these, many of these issues, like say, certain things were not allowed, adultery, divorce, retaliation, all many of these things are not allowed. But some of things were allowed, say divorce on one particular. Many times people used to take the retaliation. But Jesus says, filled with love. I said the law of love. In the past it was said, you heard it was said, but now I say to you. That is the interpretation of Jesus. Now, this is how Jesus fulfilled the law. This is what the new dimension that Jesus brings. Everybody knows what was said about anger in the Old Testament, about adultery in the Old Testament. But now Jesus gives a new dimension to each of these aspects. And then I told you the most important part of the heart of the Sermon on the Mount are these three, almsgiving, prayer, and fasting. And at the heart of this is the prayer, and that too, the prayer, Our Father. Once this Our Father, these three things are over, Jesus shows threefold contrast. What is the true treasure in heaven and on earth? Healthy eye and unhealthy eye. True master, who is God, and then the evil, the mammon. And followed by you have three negative imperatives. Of course, what is intended is positive. Do not worry. Do not judge. Do not profane. The next slide. Do not worry, do not judge, do not profane. Immediately after these three negative imperatives, you have three positive imperatives. Ask, search, knock. Now, though it is a do not worry negative imperative, the meaning is always positive. It means trust in the Lord. But do not judge. Why you do not judge? Because judgment belongs to God. God will judge. Do not profane, because God is holy. Now, something that is very beautiful. And after these things, we have the golden rule. know, after this, and then the narrow gate. And then the Sermon on the Mount ends with the three important concerns. No, this is something to do with the discipleship. How do we recognize the true disciple? You judge the tree from its fruits. You cannot say that you are a disciple of Christ in words and then your deeds are wrong. So you can see, one can judge the tree from its fruit. A warning against deception. No, because I can deceive others. I can put up a mask and then I can say something, but I may not do it. And therefore, these three things deal with very precisely what should be the behavior of a disciple. And then the Sermon on the Mount ends with the concluding summary there. Now, I just would like to just focus on the Beatitudes, because the Beatitudes, they are like, say, there are some passages always, they become like a bridge or a door to enter. Say, for example, in the Old Testament, if you want to know what is the book of Psalms, you read Psalm 1. It speaks about a wise man and a foolish man. So when you are reading through the book of Psalms, it speaks to me whether I'm a wise man based on these prayers, whether I'm living the life or I'm a foolish man. Here also, the Beatitudes are like a door. They're introduction to the Sermon on the Mount, but also they are like a door to it. Because if you know the Beatitudes, then you can also get into the depths of the Sermon on the Mount. Some may people think, okay, I will carry the Sermon on the Mount. I will take the printout of the Sermon on the Mount, carry in my pocket. It's like a useful tips to share with others. In fact, well, they are certainly a guide to our life. But more than that, they are also blessings, no? The expressions of blessing. And at the heart of the Sermon on the Mount is that God is inaugurating his reign, that in Jesus, we have the kingdom of God that is taking place. And therefore, these Beatitudes are the essence of the Christian life. And there are three things. Say, for example, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The next slide, Yesu. Blessed are the, say, for example, I just see, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom. So blessed are the poor. It's a proclamation. It's a blessing. God is blessing you. Then poor in spirit, that is characterization. And then finally comes promise, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. I remember a couple of years when I was teaching, Father, why does Jesus say poor, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven? Is God, is Jesus exalting poverty? Now, something that I just shared with this particular little insight on the poor in the spirit, what Matthew intends. In fact, a poor in spirit means people are deprived of the basic necessities, and that poverty hits the inner spirit. It's not the Holy Spirit, it's my spirit. It hits my inner spirit. And in that inner spirit, I realize that God is not there in my life, but there's a longing that God will one day will give me back what I lack. I depend on God. There's something called anavim. In the midst of, it is not that Jesus is glorifying the poverty, but even in my deprivation, even in my poverty, I trust in the Lord. I depend on the Lord. Though it feels like God is absent, he's still there and he will give me the rightful place back. And that's the blessing that Jesus is giving to his disciples. And that is something threefold structure you find in all the eight Beatitudes. Now, if you have seen the structure, I told you chapter 5 to 7 deal with Jesus' teaching. So Jesus is presented as the messianic teacher. So can we go to the next slide and then we come back? You can look at that. That was the next slide. Yeah. The next slide. Yeah, fine. You can see here Matthew 5 to 7. Jesus is presented as the teacher and interpreter of the Torah. That is the new law in the Sermon on the Mount. Immediately after these messianic words in chapter 5 and 7, chapter 8 and 9 deal with the messianic deeds of Jesus, where Jesus is presented as a messianic wonderful work. Now, these miracles of Jesus, some people often think that it's like a magic. You can find that in these two chapters, especially chapter 8 and 9. Of course, the miracles are also put later, but Matthew beautifully organizes 10 miracles. If you look at these two passages, there are 10 miracles. Some say there are 9 miracles, but you can say that they are presented as 3, then there's a break, 3, then 3, there is a break, and then 3, there is a break. So we can go to the next slide, where I will show you. Next slide. So here you can see, how does this miracle cycle begin? Healing of the leper, centurion servant, and Jesus heals Peter's mother-in-law. Then there is a break, summary, and then something about discipleship. Then we go to the next slide, you will find three miracles. There's a nature miracle, storm at sea. Then there is an exorcism, and then there is a healing. Then there is a break. Jesus calls a disciple, and then he speaks about the discipleship again. Then comes again the next cycle. Next slide. There are three miracles. You see the raising of the official's daughter, woman with a hemorrhage, and two blind men, muted demonic. Now, very interesting. Some people consider the first and the second miracle together as one, because it is like a story within a story. Jesus begins his journey to go to the official's house, but on the way, he meets a woman with a hemorrhage, and then he heals, and then he goes to officials. It is something called, in the scholars, it's like a sandwich technique. Now, what is the sandwich? You know, there's a bread, and then you have the ingredients, and again, you have a bread. So Jesus begins with the story of, Matthew begins with the story of the official's daughter, then comes something that is being sandwiched, another story, and then he comes back to another story. So you can remember, if the story which began and then it is completed after another story in the Bible, it's always a sandwich technique. Another example to give of the sandwich technique is Jesus fig tree, that Jesus goes to a tree and then he does not find the fruit. Okay, then Jesus goes to the temple, he does not find the fig. Then Jesus goes to the tree, he does not find the fruit. It is the tree is withered away. So it is called a sandwich technique. The meaning, important, it is not that Jesus did not find the fruit. The author wanted to tell that Jesus did not find the faith in the temple. The people were not believing in Jesus. So that point he wants to highlight in the story. So you will find that various miracles are found. Healing miracles, the nature miracle. There's a question about, I want to tell, because many of our Christian brothers think that when we go to the retreat center, prayers, God does magic and miracles happen. No? But what we find actually in the Gospels, I can speak to you on another occasion only on the miracles of Jesus. What we find is that when Jesus does a miracle, there's always an interpersonal relationship between Jesus and the one who is healed or the miracle is done. And either Jesus seizes the initiative, or a leper or somebody or a centurion comes to Jesus, makes use of the time when Jesus is around. And the result, the final result of that initiative is the faith. Jesus does not utter words. Say some, if you go to some places, you say blah, 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 people talking. But Jesus' words are very intelligible in his miracle. Get up, walk, your sins are forgiven. Jesus does not say, speak in tongues. He simply speaks in a very profound, very precise way. When he heals someone, get up, take your mat. So you remember, what is a magic? If you go to a magician, he will utter all those nonsensical words. But Jesus' words are words of faith and intelligence. Use of power. Whenever Jesus makes use of the power in the miracles, it is not to destroy someone. It is something to bring, say, bring healing to a person. And Jesus' miracles are in obedience to God's will. You remember that Jesus could have easily come down from the cross. People are asking, if you are the Messiah, come down from the cross. If Jesus were to come down from the cross, we could have called it a miracle. But it was not in obedience to God's will. Therefore, whenever Jesus does a miracle, it's always in obedience to God's will. Most of the miracles that Jesus does are in the communitarian context, no, in the presence of people, so that they know the reign of God, the kingdom of God is inaugurated. Second, and the last point is that when Jesus does a particular miracle, people are not harmed. When you go to a magician or a soothsayer or someone reads your hand or something, very often they give you some fruits or lemons or some chilies. Why? In order to destroy the life of your neighbor or someone else. But in Jesus' ministry, nothing of that happens. No superstition. It's always meant for the well-being of the other person, okay? So when you read Jesus' miracles, keep these seven things in mind. And when the miracle cycle ends, there's a beautiful statement which says that when Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion on the crowds because they were harassed and helpless. They were like a sheep without a shepherd. And Jesus felt that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Now, very important, two words, sheep without a shepherd and the harvest is plentiful and the laborers. So the miracle cycle with these two imagery, sheep without a shepherd, and then the harvest and the laborers, point us towards the mission of the disciples. And therefore, the next passage is the mission discourse. Chapter 10 is the mission discourse. And in this, we can find, I'm just going quickly, you can later read, I put it in a very simple way, that whatever Jesus prays to the Father has been granted to him in his prayer. And therefore, you will find in the, we go to the next slide, Yesu, that the mission discourse is chapter 10, verses 1 to 42. You can look at here, I have put all the passages. The most important element of this is this A, Y, and this D. In other words, identification of the disciples with Master. In the mission discourse, the most important thing, a disciple, the basis of the mission of a disciple is Jesus. As long as he identifies himself with Jesus, that is his mission. You cannot say, a disciple cannot say, my mission is different from Jesus' mission. Therefore, it's beautiful, no? You will find a kind of a sequence. John the Baptist, his mission. And immediately when John the Baptist arrives on the scene, Jesus arrives. So there's a kind of a continuation of the mission of the kingdom. And after Jesus, that continuity is in the disciples. And therefore, though there is no uniformity, there's a kind of a unity in their mission. And therefore, the disciples' mission basically is a continuation of Jesus' mission, provided he identifies himself with the Master. So you can read these three aspects later. And the mission discourse highlights three important things. Firstly, the strategy for mission. The strategy, if you want to be the disciple of Jesus, you have to renounce the material security. Okay? The basis of mission, as I shared with you, is a disciple has to follow the example of Jesus. He cannot call himself as a Messiah or Savior. That's why whenever you find in the gospel, disciples all wanted to do on their own. Once even they said, let's bring down the fire on the people. It is their mission. Jesus says, no, that is not in obedience to God's will. No. And the third important thing is the condition for mission. No. What is the mission? When you go out, Jesus does not promise them a bed of roses. There will be thorns, conflict and persecution. Jesus' mission, John the Baptist's mission, met with opposition. He was beheaded. Jesus' mission met with opposition. He was crucified. And Jesus cannot promise a bed of roses to his disciples. He tells, this is the condition where you go, you will face conflicts and persecutors. That's why here in Rome, there's a beautiful basilica where you have, if you have been here, the Basilica of Basilica Laterano, no? The John the Lateran. There are the statues of the 12 apostles. And you will find with the each statue how this disciple was martyred, except for John, who died, traditionally believed that he died in his old age. Otherwise, there are huge life-size statues of these 12 apostles because people believed that, means according to the scripture, the church is founded on these 12 apostles and their martyrdom witness. And you will find that these disciples, 12 disciples, went out, died. And that's the witness why we are church today. And therefore, this is the heart of the mission discourse. Then we move quickly to the most important aspect in the Gospel of Matthew is the parable discourse. Now, something to tell you that Jesus was a master storyteller. No? Now, once Jesus speaks messianic words in the Sermon on the Mount, and then when Jesus speaks, does his messianic deeds, immediately there's a rejection and opposition. So there is no in-between. Either you follow Jesus or you reject Jesus. And therefore, in the context of this, there's a parable discourse. In the parable discourse, you always have two kinds of people, no? Either you accept Jesus or you reject Jesus. Say, for example, the parable of the sower and the seed. Three types of seeds don't produce. Three types of soils don't produce anything. One type of soil produces. So you can see two types of people. I just want to say that Jesus was a master storyteller. Before Jesus' story could be written, there were stories that Jesus told. They were called parables. Jesus spoke about the human life and real life situation. He spoke about the fishermen, the farmers, and through stories, he captured the attention of the listeners. And then when he spoke in stories, he did not make the listeners to feel good. No, he actually disturbed those who were comforted and comforted those disturbed, and therefore he subverted this conventional wisdom. In fact, the word parabole means to place beside. I tell a story so that by telling my story, there is something that is within you or something in your life is being compared. So Jesus spoke in small aphorisms, like one sentence, or he said in similes, kingdom of God, like this or as compared. And then there were narrative parables, longer parables. And now Jesus told the stories not to hide the truth, but to reveal the truth about the reign of God. But many of the audience did not understand Jesus' parables. The disciples could understand because they had openness to listen to Jesus' stories. Now, the next point says, you can read this one. Jesus told stories about Jewish household, family life, fathers, sons, brothers, like the prodigal son. Jesus spoke about the animal and the natural world, like the good shepherd, sheep, leaven, farms, vineyard, trees, houses. Jesus spoke about the social life, about the masters, slaves, owners, tenants, rich, poor. He spoke about trade and commerce, business, economics, coins, pearls, merchant. So the stories, Jesus' parables, say, encaptured everyone. No, but why did Jesus use? The most important thing is that Jesus wanted to tell who God is and what his reign or kingdom is like. In other words, the centrality of Jesus' parables is the God's kingdom. And therefore, if you open chapter 13, each parable begins saying that the kingdom of God can be compared. In other words, the reign of God can be compared. So there's a truth that is told about the reign of God in each parable. So the stories were told for the sake of that. Okay. Yesu, should we continue? Or should we take some questions?
Yeah, it's 5:46, Navin. How okay. Would you like to proceed?
You give me another 5 minutes so I can I can summarize. I can conclude, okay?
Sure,
okay. Sure. Can you go back to the slide, then I will, yeah. Dear brothers and sisters, okay, I just finished half the gospel. I just reached chapter 13 and the Matthew's gospel as chapter 28. Of course, the passion narratives are most likely mostly common in all the four gospels. So you can take those three last chapters. But important thing is that once these, after the parables of Jesus are presented to the audience, these are some of the parables. We go to the next slide. There is Jesus begins to form his community because Jesus knows that the price of his sharing of the reign of God, communicating the reign of God would be cross. And therefore, he wants to form the community. And therefore, there is something called deepening of faith in Jesus. Now, there's something called crystal. So that you will find many passages like Jesus walking on the water. Peter confesses that you are the Messiah. So you can see that the disciples and the individual figures, they profess their faith. And Jesus begins to form the community. And the moment, the second one is that Jesus also speaks to them about the mission, that it is not only for the Jewish people, also you have the story of the Canaanite woman. And then finally you have the so-called the ecclesiological awareness. Jesus speaks about the community of the discipleship. No, that's where the word comes in 16:16, the so-called the ecclesia, 16:18. And once this over, once this formation is taking place, Jesus now speaks about that he's going to be crucified. So you have something called the first prediction, second prediction, third prediction. So Jesus is telling, this is the price I need to pay for. Communicating or proclaiming the kingdom of God. And then we have something called the community of discourse. Now, most important, there are two concerns in this community. When you read, you will easily get. The first is some disciples, like they want to know who is the greatest in. Many people wrongly understood. Many of Jesus' disciples wrongly understood the nature of the kingdom. They thought in terms of political kingdom. So I should be given the higher rank in the kingdom. So Jesus addresses the question of status. Now status in the kingdom. No, who is like it? Be like a child, the little one. So the first question in the community discourse, if the community of the believers is reflecting the kingdom community, everyone has to be the servant of the other, becoming like the child. Then the secondly, in the community, perhaps it is because of the background, there was a kind of a conflict with the Jewish Christians and the Jewish people outside. A lot of fights and unforgiveness. And therefore, Jesus says, forgiveness is the hallmark of my community. That is how Matthew presents that there should be interpersonal forgiveness. So I've just given you the structure of this. You can read through of the community discourse. And once the community discourse is over, you have in chapter 24, the eschatological discourse. You can read through these slides. It's very, very simple. The eschatological. Now, what is eschaton? You must keep in mind, there's some kind of an anticipation of the future. Now, people believe that that there are two forces that are at work. One is the kingdom of God and the kingdom of Satan. People believe that because there is a lot of evil in the world, Satan has more power than God in this world. Because very often we say, no, there is a lot of evil in this world. It's as if like we are under the grip of the evil one, the Satan. But Jesus is trying to tell us, well, the kingdom of God and the kingdom of Satan are the two diametrically opposed to forces. And one day there will be a real battle among. So every word and every miracle that Jesus did was to defeat the force of the devil. So whenever Jesus did an exorcism, was to defeat the force of the kingdom of Satan. And therefore, Jesus says, finally, there would be battle in which the truth will triumph. Kingdom of God will triumph. And therefore, he tells his disciples, you need to be vigilant. You need to be vigilant. And he gives the instruction. And therefore, there are parables that are told. I'm sure that you remember the parable of the 10 virgins, 5 foolish and the 5 wise ones. Now, it all that, how do I prepare for the coming of the Lord? Then we have the judgment of the nations. Very important. Now, how did I recognize Jesus in the poor and in the members of my community? Okay. So this is something with regard to the last slide that I would like to share with you, because this is a question that is asked in your review, is what is the discipleship, the concept of discipleship in the Gospel of Matthew? First of all, if you have to be a disciple, you must be called by Jesus, initiated by Jesus. That's why whether you take chapter 4, 18 to 22, where the disciples are at the Sea of Galilee, or chapter 9, where Matthew is at the tax booth, the levy, they were called by Jesus, follow me. And they rise and follow immediately. Secondly, when they follow, they submit to the authority of Jesus by following him. Therefore, who is a disciple? A disciple is the one who submits to the authority of Jesus. Thirdly, a disciple is the one who, in the Gospel of Matthew, following Jesus during his public ministry, becomes the recipient and witness of Jesus' words and deeds. No, that's why if you take chapter 13 about the parables, crowds are not able to understand. And finally, Jesus gives these parables to his disciples. So the disciples are the witnesses to Jesus' miracles, healings, and his parables and stories. In the Gospel of Matthew, the disciples are characterized as men of little faith. And that word is repeated in 6:30, 8:26, 14:31, 16:8, or 17:20. Why this particular little faith? Little faith does not mean between no faith and profound faith. No, basically they lack faith. The little faith. What happens is that in the Gospel of Mark, the evangelist gives a very dull picture of disciples. They are never able to understand. But in the Gospel of Matthew, disciples are able to understand, but they are not able to fully comprehend the identity and the teaching of Jesus. That is important. Then the discipleship in the Gospel of Matthew, like the other gospel, also entails cost. I told you in the mission discourse that the conditions of the mission, they have to suffer, they will be persecuted. Then embarking on mission, that in chapter 28, the disciples are sent out as apostles. Go, make them disciples of the, make the nations as disciples, teaching them. Then finally, the disciples form a community, and that community center around Jesus. Today we call Christian community. In that Christian, there is Christ. Now, so it's a community of disciples is centered around Jesus. Finally, discipleship entails continuing the mission of Jesus. Only in the Gospel of Matthew, you will find this word, In fact, disciple is always a noun. But in Greek, the word mathetheo is used as a verb. So it does not say that it literally means to disciple others. No? To instead of saying to make others as disciples, Matthew uses the word to disciple others. So this is the beauty of the Gospel of Matthew in terms of discipleship. This is what I wanted to share with you briefly about Matthew's Gospel. Important thing, as I said, in the Passion narrative, which we will read in the other Gospels, suicide of Judas is found only in the Gospel of Matthew. Pilate's wife as a dream, which is found only in the Gospel of Matthew. I would like to end my session here with this concluding reflection. Matthew's Gospel invites us to see Jesus as the long-awaited Messiah of Israel. Why do I say? Because there are so many groups in Israel and United States who still believe that, among the Jewish groups, that Jesus, the Messiah, is still to come. No? But we as Christians believe that Jesus is the Messiah whom God sent. And we are encouraged to accept this Christ, Messiah, and become the living members. Important is living, not just the dead members, not just the participants or just the members. Supposed to become living members. And that's why those teachings are given to us, especially the community discourse, so that we become the living members of the church. Thank you so much. And we take up some of the questions in case you would like to ask me.
Good. Thank you. Thank you very much, Naveen, for a very good presentation.
Welcome. Yes, welcome.
And you are able Thank to you. Conclude with that statement, and you have challenged us also in the sense that
Thank you, sir.
Things were real challenges, like not we master the word of God, but the master word of God has to master and it has to take possession of us, and that was challenging.
Yes.
And your last observation of Matthew, that was indeed challenge, that we become living members. Very good. Yeah. Thank you for the contribution.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
And not only talked about the lesson, but also you challenged through your own interpretation and how you look at. So it tells us how you are rooted in your very style, very research. And we are happy that you are doing your research in the Gospel of Mark. And we wish you all the doctoral research. And when you defend
Thank
it,
you, so much.
You tell us our students also will participate if it's online.
Oh, yeah, sure. So, thank you so much. Yes.
Thank you. Now, two questions have come up from Mr. Joseph Lobo. One is that why was this or all other gospels were written so late, that is about 30 to 40 years after the death of Jesus, number one.
Okay.
Another one is by the same person, Mr. Joseph Lobo. Jesus changed many of the Old Testament laws. Doesn't it amount to abolishment of those laws?
Okay, the first question is very interesting, because what happened was why the Gospels were written immediately, actually after the death and resurrection of Jesus, the disciples went out and started proclaiming. So it was at the proclamatory, charismatic level, I proclaim. So nobody thought of sitting and writing down the Gospels. But eventually, the initial witnesses of Jesus, those who saw Jesus' life, they were dying and slowly, and they were very in limited number. And secondly, the communities were coming up. So, and also many other writings were coming up, Gnostic writings were coming up. Therefore, the credible witnesses of Jesus, where the apostles preached the Gospels, those communities took up writing of the Gospel. So you can find that after the, if Jesus was, did his public ministry in the first stage, in the first part of the first century. The second part of the first century was the proclamatory stage, the so-called charismatic, I go and out proclaim. Only later, when the disciples, apostles were slowly dying, people, the community started writing down so that it is not missed by the future generation. And that's why the Gospels are written a bit later in the third part of the century. The second question is that in the Gospel according to Matthew, Jesus does not abolish the law. Jesus does not even change the law, but Jesus gives a new interpretation of the law, that see why the laws were made. They were supposed to be helpful to the humans. No, therefore, Jesus relativizes the law in the context of the human. I'm saying the laws were the will of God, they were basically given for the well-being of the people. And therefore, say, take, for example, Matthew chapter 12, where there's a first conflict with regard to the law. The first with regard to eating the bread, like they pluck the grains on the day of Sabbath, and then Jesus healing on the day of Sabbath. These are the two Sabbath controversies. Now, what Jesus says in that, that Jesus gives a new interpretation of the law. It is not that Jesus abolishes the law, but it is not the letter of the law that matters, but is the spirit of the law that matters in the Gospel of Matthew. And Jesus, being a teacher, is able to reinterpret the law in the Gospel of Matthew. Okay? Yes, I'm not able to hear you.
Father, you are muted.
Yes. Thank you, Navin. Thank you, Navin, yes, for the clarifications.
Yes.
And two more clarifications. I mean, with that, we'll conclude. So
yes.
One by Mr. Sunil, that yes, has two questions. That is, why did Jesus speak in parables and not plainly, since most of the audience were simple, ordinary people? And again, he has asked, why did Jesus say repent and believe and not believe and repent? And because it is my belief in a holy and loving God that should lead to repentance. So that's one. Another one by Mrs. Anjana Grace Biswas. Was it a tradition to with oil, as we find different women doing this, including Mary Magdalene and Lazarus' sister? So one about parable, repent and believe, and anointing with oil.
The first one is, why did Jesus speak in stories? No, because the stories actually communicate faster than any abstract teachings. Now, I just want to tell you, go and read the Sermon on the Mount, which is a pure legal teaching. Many of you will find it very difficult to understand, but you go and read the parables, the message comes very fast. That's why you see many of our priests begin their homilies with a small anecdote or a life-changing incident or a story, so that you communicate the message. Do you tell your children, do you tell them stories, or you start telling them, say, a very basic abstract concept? No, always you begin with some stories, because story has a message. And that's why Jesus, but the stories that Jesus told were not simple stories. I told you that Jesus comforted the disturbed and disturbed the comforted. So there was a subversive element in Jesus' stories. That's the most important. Though it may look like Jesus simply said the stories, but at the bottom line, there's a punch in that particular story. Secondly, why Jesus said repent and believe in the gospel? Because see, the baptism of John was about repentance. John began a baptism of repentance. So if you see chapter 3, verse 5, all of Judea went to John. They had to confess their sins. So the first thing is that if you want to receive a baptism with John, you repent. So it is, but when Jesus says the repentance, in the sense, it is not that you begin with the belief, but that is the starting point from where John has begun. So you have received the baptism, repent, and now you believe in the good news. Interestingly, John was not proclaiming the good news. You see, he does not use the word. He only says, repent, the kingdom of God is at hand. The good news is not the subject of John the Baptist. He is not given the good news. Good news is Jesus. Therefore, he cannot tell. And therefore, Jesus says, in order to believe good news, the prior condition, you have to repent. You need to acknowledge that. I'm saying that we are sinful, and now we believe in the good news. We are ready to accept Jesus. So there is a continuity. Jesus does not discontinue something. He continues, but he brings a newness. Repentance of John, but believing the good news of Jesus. So two elements come together. Then the third question that was asked, I did not get used to be.
Anointing. But why do women anoint Jesus' feet? Or what was the custom?
Why did the woman anoint Jesus?
Woman anointing.
Was it a tradition, she was asking?
Okay. See, actually, the anointing, there are two purposes. You can anoint someone as a sign of welcome someone to the house, like, no? Another is anointing in the context, because you see in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 26 or Mark chapter 14, these anointing take place in the context of passion. So in other words, it is connected with that Jesus burial, because see, it is very important that we see Jesus as a Christ and the Messiah. But if you go through the Gospel, that in the contemporary eyes, Jesus died as a criminal. They crucified him. Therefore, in those times, no criminal was anointed. But the believers of Jesus knew that this was a special man. This was a man sent from God. And therefore, his body had to be anointed, just like any other Jewish bodies were anointed. No, but that's why you can say, actually, it does not occur in the Gospel of Matthew, but I can share with you in Gospel of John chapter 12, Mary anoints Jesus in Bethany. And then she say with her hair, she wipes the feet. Now, something beautiful is that in the Mediterranean, in the ancient Near East, only a woman can do that to her husband. Means that much of intimacy should. And Jesus knew that this family in Bethany was his closest family. Just before his passion, he visited them. So you can see Mary, one side, she has a gratitude because Jesus has raised her brother to life, Lazarus. Secondly, she welcomes him to her family. Thirdly, another underlining point is that Judas says, can this money to be used to give to the poor? So there are two types of contrast. The man who called Jesus, the man who was called by Jesus, weighs or measures Jesus in terms of money. But there is a woman who was a friend of Jesus, weighs the person of Jesus more than the perfume could cost. You see, there are two types of discipleship presented in that particular episode. So women are presented as a model disciple. And also, I seem to have once preached in my homily that usually it may look like a radical for some of you, that Jesus washed the feet of his disciple in chapter 13. Usually, the servants wash the feet of a person when they enter the house. But Jesus washed the disciples' feet in the upper room inside the house. So from where did Jesus learn this gesture? Perhaps he might have learned from one chapter earlier in chapter 12 from Mary. And for me, that is the basis why today women are included in the washing of the feet. Something that beautifully can gain from the scripture that they deserve whose feet to be washed at the Last Supper, no? When we celebrate every Monday, Thursday. So this is what I wanted to share with you.
Very good, Naveen. Thank you, Naveen.
Thank you,
Naveen, once again, on behalf of the chairman and all the participants and all the students of our class. I wholeheartedly thank you for your availability, generosity.
Thank you,
and for your scientific presentation. And you have not only presented what was in the lesson, and by your own extra observations on the text, and you have inspired us also for not only learning the word of God, but also putting into practice. Thank you very much, Nav.
Thank you, Yesu, for giving this opportunity to interact with your students of the Biblical College. I'm immensely grateful. And I give this PowerPoint, which also I had prepared and taught in JD, Jnanadeep, okay, in Pune. And this is also how the scholarship grows. If you find something extra in my PowerPoint, this is like how the scholarship is growing from the notes that you have received. So that's the beauty of how we learn the gospel. So thank you, Yesu. And thanks to all of you for patiently listening to me for the last 2 hours. God bless you.
Thank you, Father.
Will you thank you.
Father Naveen, yes. I have a question.
Father, yes, who is George? I think.
Yes.
Father has to go to lunch because it's 2:30 there.
Okay, Father. One minute, Father.
Okay.
What you can do is that Father Yesu will give my email ID to you. In case I have some questions, you can write to me. I will respond to it.
Okay Father.
So that's another thing that you just mentioned, that you are the student of Father Yesu in this biblical course, and then I will write back to you if you have any query. Okay, I can do it in the days to come. Okay, sure.
Okay, Father.
Yes.
George, the question
thank
is, Father.
George, thank you. You could just put that in the comment box. I will mail to
my email ID Father Yesu will give you. You can write to me by email, and then I will respond to you. Okay, so just
okay, Father. Thank you.
Yes, yes, Naveen, you could.
Thank you, Father.
Lord Jesus, we thank you for giving us the last 2 hours to read your word, to share your word, to reflect on your word, and by which to live your word. The Gospel of Matthew is an example where Jesus shares the mystery, the beauty of the reign of God May our life reflect the reign of God that is present within us. This prayer we make through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you, and may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.